Wow, this is a weird feeling.
We're finally completing it again. Within it
lies yeah, it's not like we totally had to redo this part, thanks Audacity, but yeah.
God, Kingdom Hearts is a bit lame in this game. It's just a door in the sky on a single platform.
So I'm gonna have I asked you this question when we first did this part, but so everybody gets confused on what Kingdom Hearts really is, you know, because in this game they're like, oh, it's a door, and then KH2 they're like, oh, it's a door, but then in BBS like, oh, it's a giant heart moon.
The ones in KH1 and KH2 are artificial Kingdom Hearts, aren't they? And the one in KH1 was made when Ansem got all the Princesses of Light together. And like Axis Deru Hollow Bastion, the one in Kingdom Hearts 2 was Gathering Hearts. And the one in BBS is the only natural one.
So basically Kingdom Hearts is just it's whatever you want it to be, really.
I can be whatever you want me to be, baby.
Kingdom Hearts is the friends that we made along the way, basically.
Gosh, Sora, I guess we truly were the Kingdom Hearts 358 over 2 days.
You know what? Here's the thing. I never actually got, like, why that game is called. Like, I got the 2 part, but I never understood the 358 over 2 days until a couple of days ago, and I was listening to a podcast, and they were talking about the reason why it's called 358 over 2 days.
It's 358 days over 2 days.
Well, here's the other thing. Do you know why it's the number 358?
Yeah, because Roxas spends a week in the simulation.
Yeah, I didn't know that. I was like, holy cow.
Yeah, didn't
like,
you know that?
So much... No, I always just thought, oh, there's 358 days in the game. I was like, oh, whatever, I'm not going to think about it.
Sora was in there for a year, wasn't he? So, it's Roxas following him for the last week of Roxas's life, quote-unquote, was in the simulated Twilight Town.
It's always weird to me when I think about that. Like, he's really only in that pod for a year, maybe. And he grows so much in a year. Like, I don't think it's how puberty... I know we make this show, but that's not how puberty works.
It depends, like, because what didn't he go from 14 to 15? Like, you can get a pretty big growth spurts during that time. That's pretty natural.
I don't know.
Especially,
I don't
like,
know.
From in that stage of your life, for sure you will. Like, I had a big growth spurt from that age.
Oh yeah, so you're gonna be fair. You're talking to somebody here who hit puberty late and is still 5'4", so I'm like, thanks, Sora, jerk. And we've talked about this boss fight. We've like mentioned it in past parts, but this boss fight is okay. Like, it's definitely one of the weakest final bosses in the series. I know you're gonna say 0.2's final boss, whose name I can't think of is worst, which I will agree. I will agree with you on that. That boss fight is the worst. But this boss fight's not bad. It's more so just it's really long and it just kind of it overstays its welcome. That's what really hurts it. Like this part of the fight, I'm absolutely okay with. It's like they have a lot. This is a problem that we talk about with other Kingdom Hearts games. 2 has this problem really bad as well. The final boss has way too many phases and it's never like.
The problem with 2 is that it had one too many phases. If you just removed the dragon phase, it would have been perfect.
Yeah.
The other phases are fine. I just removed that dragon phase.
I would get rid of one of the armored Xemnas phases.
No,
I think
like,
you don't really need
one?
2.
Probably
the first one.
Yeah, I guess so.
With this fight kind of has it too, because like we're not at it yet, but like there's a part where you're gonna fight this giant Gurren Lagann ship looking thing's face that you could probably get rid of, I think, or I don't know. One thing I will say, while I don't like the design of this giant enemy, like I think it is too big. His giant stando in the back is pretty awesome. I do really like it, and you brought this up, but it has a dragon necklace and the faces move, and that's really awesome.
Yeah. My problem with this boss is. I don't feel like it has a lot of presence. Like, it's big and imposing, but it's my problem with big bosses in general. They're really hard to get right, because the rest of his body isn't really moving or doing anything. You're just hitting his, like, isolated core. And a lot of big, like, bosses have these problems in video games. Like, I'm just hitting this dude's, like, leg or a part of his body. It doesn't feel like I'm, like, defeating him in a meaningful way. Whereas 2 is just a one-on-one human fight. and it feels like you're against someone with a similar moveset to yours, and that makes it a lot more intense and engaging compared to this, where I'm just hitting a part of a big dude. It's not very fun.
KH has never been good at big bosses. Like, even in 2, when you fight, I can't think of his name, but it's that boss in Pride Land.
Grand Shaper.
There you go. Like, that boss, the first time I played it, because I was, like, 10, I was like, this boss is awesome, because he's really big, you know? But you go back and you play a fight, and you're like, wow, this fight's not that good.
But Shadow of the Colossus is how you do kind of big bosses. Like, they're really hard to do in video games. But just don't do them, because like, a lot of games don't do them well.
I think you brought this up in a previous part. It may have been when we did this part, it was a previous part for sure, but you were talking about like platinum games, like you take a Bayonetta where they have big bosses. I've never played Bayonetta, I really want to get on that one of these days. But like, Bayonetta has big bosses, but it's never as good as compared to something like Metal Gear Rising or Revengeance, whatever, where you like, you have that sand fight, which is awesome.
Yeah, because it's like, it's fighting people with like your core similar abilities, and that's something I love. The rival character is the best boss fight in video games, for sure. It's like one of the best boss mechanics. The problem with big bosses, like, I love Bayonetta, but I just don't think hitting things' faces and different body parts is engaging. For Shadow of the Colossus, the whole game was built around it. It's not about like having a grand scale thing. It's more about this is a living, breathing monster, and the puzzle is climbing up it and seeing how you can like take down such a beast.
It's more about the experience, yeah, with Shadow of the Colossus, yeah.
Even in Metal Gear Rising, like, there's the rules of nature, and like, even the Metal Gear fights, I don't think they're that good in that game, honestly.
I think it depends, like, when you're doing a big boss, if you can, I think it depends on the game. I think you could do a stealth game with a big boss, and that could kind of work. Like, that actually kind of fits there, because it's supposed to be intimidating, and it works in that
Dark Souls does big bosses really well, actually. That's
there you go. When you have something like, to me, like, KH is not that, I don't know, it doesn't work well with big bosses. Like, that's one thing, when we've seen of KH 3, like, when you see that rock type,
I was
fight,
just about to
bring
that up, yeah, that, it didn't look very good.
But all the other bosses that we've seen look fine, so I'm like, that's so weird. And like, and it's even like with this game, like, we have this fight, even like the rock titan fight, when we saw that, the rock titan fight's kind of boring, ice titan's not very fun to, I don't know, fight. More so because I don't like that fight, but you know. But yeah, we are 7 minutes into this part, and this final boss is still going. One thing I will say, I like a final boss that's challenging, but I hate bosses that go on forever. And this fight goes on until, I think, the 16-minute mark, so. And I'm not gonna say that, and part of that is because I'm not good at Kingdom Hearts 1, I will fully admit that, but this fight takes forever. I don't know. Your first playthrough will take you quite a bit of time to beat this guy, I've always thought, but I don't know. Like, it's not hard. Like, you can beat this fight pretty easily, but, you know.
It's weird because, like, the phase before this is, like, way more engaging with, like, fighting Ansem one-on-one with a standoff compared to this, where I mentioned this in the previous part we had to redo, and how does Ansem do this? Because he's just like, he's a standard Heartless, but he can create this massive kind of like dickship Heartless monster. How come Xemnas couldn't do anything on this? Well, Xemnas was meant to do something in this scale in KH2, but it got cut. But do you know what I mean? It's,
yeah.
How come, like, Ansem can just do this? Why doesn't he just do this all the time? Is it because he's in Kingdom Hearts, or what? They don't explain this? Why doesn't Ansem, like, when he appears again, he just transforms into this fucking thing?
Yeah. This is a complete fan theory, but like you said, I think it's just because he's close to Kingdom Hearts. That's the only thing I could see it being, but even then, it's still kind of like, eh, I don't know. It's a little weird.
Just do this all the time, dude.
Like, in KH3, I don't want this fight to come back, but it would make sense if they brought it back for no reason, so.
And Riku will have to fight him again.
If I'm just saying this now, if we really do get another Riku, I'm not afraid of the darkness, or I'm gonna be kind of upset.
I mentioned this, I think it's the previous part we did, but there's a Twitter account called Kate Quotes Out of Context, and one of them is Riku in Dream Drop Distance, and it's when he's in Notre Dame, and he's standing next to young Xehanort, and young Xehanort says, "Look at your best friend," and he's pointing to Ansem.
This is probably the hardest phase of this fight, as weird as that sounds, because this boss can't really, and this guy can't do anything to you.
No,
he's
it's
just
lightning,
giant.
It just packs a punch, really.
Yeah, it's kind of similar to like Ursula's fight in Atlantica, I guess, where he just spams it. But, like I said, this fight's not really, the only hard thing about this fight is just because of how long it is. It's not even that it's really that hard. And one thing that is, I will give Cage one a good thing for this is it doesn't send you all the way back to the first Ansem fight if you fail this, which is really good, because that would be a nightmare.
But I'm not sure if this game did it or as well. It's a big problem in KH2, but actually, no, it's introducing BBF. So with KH1 and KH2, I think this is a bigger problem in KH2, and you're going to agree with me on this, I think. The continue button. So there'd be points in KH2 where, like, you clear out a room or something, and this is quite a large area, and if you die, you can't retry a specific part, you have to click continue, and sometimes it will just send you back to the beginning of the screen, and you have to collect all your treasure chests, all your shit again, and that was a big problem in early KH games, for sure.
Yeah, I remember specifically when DSP was doing KH2, and we were watching him, especially, it was when he was doing the MCP fight. He kept, like, dying, so he had to always recollect the chest, and he was getting so pissed off about it.
Dream Drop Distance has, Dream Drop Distance, you could retry specific rooms, but there's one room in DDD, in the world that never was, which is massive. It's like, when you first go there, it's with Riku, and if you die there, you have to do the massive room all over again, and it's a pain in the ass.
That section on, I haven't played on Critical, but on Proud is a nightmare. Pun intended, actually, with that one.
Yeah.
But, you know. Yeah. I don't think DDD is a very hard game until you get to that later. It's probably until you get to the world that never was is when I start having a really hard time with it, because I'm just like, I don't know. It's Riku's section only. Like, Sora's part's not that bad, because, like, you're only going to fight Xemnas there.
Well, Sora's part's weird, because it's a hallway in Sora's part of DDD. Like, he has those cutscenes where he's kind of, like, spacing out, then he runs through, like, two screens of hallways, and then, like, his section's over. He fights Xemnas when his section's over.
One thing I don't like about this final boss of this game is that it's pretty... Now, I'm gonna show a trick when I end this boss that you can land on the ground, but one thing I don't like is that it's a glide boss, and it to me, that kind of, I don't want to say it doesn't alienate the player, but it's kind of like, why can't I use all these skills I've really worked really hard to get through the entire game?
You brought up, like, that's the big problem with this. It's introducing mechanics, what you just learned in Neverland. How come this is the big fighting mechanic for the final portion of the game? Like, we're not used to fighting in this style. That's what was so good about KH2's final boss. It felt like, what I love, the first reaction command for Xemnas is the first reaction command you learn, which is reversal against the nobodies.
Yeah.
It's like bringing it back around to the beginning. Because, like, Xemnas, he throws you up in the air, and then you use reversal to dodge his lightning attacks. It's such a good turnaround. Like, they knew what they were doing there, and you're using all the skills you've learned to defeat him. And here, it's just like, here's a move you learned what the previous two worlds have fun. Oh, okay.
Two kind of, well, it has the best of both worlds. So technically, it does introduce one new thing where you do play as Riku towards the end of that fight. So it is something new, but it's still very similar to what you've done before. So it does both.
Can we be real? Did you, when you first play KH2, did you die in that bit because you didn't have any idea what you were doing?
What, the Riku part?
I did. When you switched to Riku, because I know I died when I first played the game. Because I was
you
like, what
confused,
the fuck?
Because you're like, what the hell?
Yeah, what am I meant to do here?
What the hell? Am I supposed to go left or right? This is bullshit.
And now you just kind of, you know, oh, I just spam Dark Aura and walk up to Sora.
Yeah. We brought this up originally, well, in the original part, but like, why is Ansem so tall now? Like, he's massive.
Some hidden heartless power, which he just uses now. Okay, one thing I do like about this design, I love the tendrils, which are connected to his back to the... It's kind of creepy.
Yeah, it's bad. It's pretty metal, admittedly. I also like that he's dual wielding two soul leaders.
Yeah, dual wielding soul leaders.
It's pretty awesome, I gotta admit. I do like soul leader, like, as a weapon, it's really cool.
It gives me a lot of courage when I use it.
Damn it, I knew you were gonna say it. I was like, I'm gonna try and just see if he'll go for it or not, and he did it. Son of a bitch. Also, a trick if you want to avoid his really dark spirit bomb attack is to always get behind his guardian stando thing. It'll at least buy you a little bit of time just to make sure, so it comes in handy, you know. Let's see, we are at the 15-minute mark, and...
We're still here!
We're still here! When are we gonna get to the fireworks factory? I mean, I do like this fight. It's not terrible, but... And we have to end it in the coolest way possible with Ragnarok. Taste the best Thor movie, Ansem. It's an okay final boss, but I definitely think the game could have ended. At least with a better boss, you know, but I'll take what I can get. Also, in this cutscene, Ansem does not have his shirt. In the next cutscene, he has his shirt back.
Hey, you just put it back on.
Yeah, just during the explosion, he's like, oh shit, I forgot the shirt.
Yeah, oh shit. Give me a sec, guys.
It's a little brisk out here in the darkness.
Yeah. Oh, I'm freezing. I'm freezing over here.
And yeah, after that, we've technically... Well, technically, we have completed Kingdom Hearts 1. Gameplay-wise, we have. So... And here's the famous cutscene that everybody loves. It is futile. The Keyblade. I miss Billy Zane. I really do. He's so good.
Yeah, I miss him so much.
I can't believe Billy Zane's fucking dead.
Yeah, he's fucking dead. With the power of darkness.
Oh, I do like this cutscene. Like, it is really cheesy.
It's iconic. It's one of the more iconic Kingdom Hearts. Everyone knows this one. Supreme
darkness! You're wrong. I know now, without a doubt, Kingdom Hearts is light! 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 Light!
Light! Light! Oh, he does it! Light! Oh, how he says that.
So, if this destroys Ansem, why didn't Sora just shine a torch on him or something?
Exactly.
Oh, a flashlight. Sorry, the Americans out there. A flashlight. Why didn't Sora just shine a flashlight on him?
Exactly. It's like, everybody kind of makes this joke, but like when Sonic Adventure 1, why didn't like Sonic just, and actually I think that people who make Sonic shorts actually made an animated thing about this. It's like when Sonic's fighting Perfect Chaos, why doesn't he just get a toaster and just throw it in the water and kill Perfect Chaos? Oh look, it's Planet Phazon from Metroid Prime. I can't. Don't give up. Come on, Sora. You brought this up, but this ending's actually kind
of
sad.
This is my favorite ending of the series.
Really?
You could have ended the series here, and it would have been fine.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I prefer the KH2 ending a little more, just because I think it's. It's kind of bittersweet, I guess, because like, oh, everything's back to normal, and then that secret
also,
ending.
Also, I love, like, oh. Spoilers, Mickey Mouse is in this game, but this has the best use of Mickey in the series, I think. I love how, like, he's just talked about, and he just shows up now at the end as this weird enigma in Lava Shadows.
Well, yeah, there is a reason for that.
Yeah, but... I know, like, they were like, this game might be fucking awful, but it's still cool.
And my favorite thing still is that we actually have a game that explains why he doesn't have a shirt. That is so stupid, but it's awesome at the same time.
Aqua's just lying on a beach, meanwhile. She might be fighting Devil's Wave right now. Oh, no, she wouldn't be. She's lying on the beach. She fights Devil's Wave with Mickey before this.
Yeah. Well, no, she fights him a little bit after, too, because she fights him part of that cutscene.
Yeah.
Which Mickey voice do you prefer? Do you like the old guy or the new guy?
Well, for Mickey, the old guy. The new guy sucks.
take care of her.
I've gotten more used to it. I think the new guy's gotten a lot better over the years. Like, when he first started, he was very rough, but he's definitely gotten better.
One of my favorite songs in the series, always in my mind, playing that. I love this track so much.
It's kind of sad, because KH, like, its endings never get better. Like, they get worse after 2, I think.
Dream Drop Distance.
Yeah. 0.2 has a pretty good ending, now think about it.
I might say something a bit, not controversial, but coming from me, I'm turning around on something. I think I find Dream Drop Distance stories worse than Days.
Maybe.
Hear me out.
Maybe.
Days exists within its own little bubble, if you know what I mean. So, Days, like, it's so inconsequential, apart from Shion. Like, Days literally retcons itself within the same game. So it's like, we can't have anything too important happening here. So, here's a character, oh, now she's gone, no one remembers her. Like, they wrap it up within the same game, so you don't really need to know about it. DDD is so important to the plots going within 3. And the stuff it does is so shitty that I think it makes it worse in hindsight.
Yeah. I think DDD's a worse... I'm trying to think how I want to put this. The DDD story is... admittedly, I will agree, it is... I think its writing is worse than Days. I just think DDD's a bit more funny because how stupid it is.
I guess
than Days.
So, yeah.
Like, Days isn't well written. It's more like, it's just kind of like, this is cringy, but it's not like, as a narrative, it's passable, I think. It's just, we don't really like Shion, so.
Kairi!
You left the tacos in the microwave.
Yeah.
Kairi! Remember what you said before? I'm always with you too. I'll come back to you. I promise! I know you will!
I love Simple and Clean. It's so good. Like, it sounds weird, but I've kind of got to the point now when I think of Kingdom Hearts, I think of this ending for some reason. I don't know why, but it sticks with you.
Yeah, it's pretty iconic. I just noticed Kairi has a purple armband after all these years of playing this game on KH1 Design. I've never
yeah,
known.
You learn something new every
I've
day.
I've never noticed that until now. Jesus Christ.
I'm kind of glad Kairi got a redesign. I mean, she obviously has to get a redesign, but I like her KH2 design so much more than her 1 design.
I don't know. The 2 design looks a bit silly because of, like, the zipper dress.
I can get that. What do you think about her 3 design, or what we've seen of it?
I think it looks cool.
I like it. It looks pretty snazzy.
I think honestly, like, out of the 3, Sora, Riku, Kairi, Sora's is good, but I think it's the weakest one. Just in comparison to his previous design.
Yeah, I'd agree.
I think it goes Riku, Kairi, and Sora in terms of trio. Because Riku is the king. It's so good. I've heard some concerns, but like, the majority I've like talked to just love Riku's new design.
Yeah. Oh, his design's really good. The CG for this is still pretty good looking, actually. Like, it's definitely age, but it still looks good.
Can we explore the town of Destiny Islands in 3, please?
That would be a cool, like, in-game incentive. Like, you beat the game and you get the...
Yeah, Sora goes to school.
Yeah, I wish. KH4 is gonna start with Sora in school. Kairi walks into the cave and there's Nick Fury in the background. Kairi, we need you to join the Avengers Initiative.
I thought it was Goofy who needed to join.
Oh, yeah. That ending's sad when he fades away. That used to always be like, aw, it's sad.
Kairi, I don't feel so good.
I kind of should have seen that coming. But I do like the ending a lot. I really like this game. Talk about Kingdom Hearts. You're good at it, so.
Talk about Kingdom Hearts. Oh, wow. We've only got, like, 50 minutes left, man. I like this game a lot. It's aged considerably, but I still go to back this to this game every year or so. I 100% it every time it comes out on any platform. If it came out on PC or Switch or something, I'd do it all again. It has a lot of kind of weird visceral charm to it, Kingdom Hearts 1. Whilst Kingdom Hearts 2 has like the best ARPG combat possibly of all time, KH1 just kind of has like this weird... It's kind of whimsical in a way. It just really feels like you're on a weird adventure compared to 2, where it's a lot more... Not true. KH1 is extremely tropey, but it's kind of tropes I prefer, like more whimsical, you're on a journey, compared to 2, where it's like, here's plot point A, here's plot point B, stop the organization, oh, look, they're gonna pop up occasionally, quote some exposition at you and go. And the Disney worlds in KH2 were more designed for combat in mind, and that's not necessarily a bad thing since it works within the context of that game. But KH1, whilst they were like the limits of a PS2, they were boxed in worlds. It kind of did encourage you to explore more. And even getting lost in stuff like Deep Jungle, yeah, the world sucks, but it kind of felt more alive in a way than any world in KH2. And the story's... I wouldn't say the story's simple, it's the most simplest out of Kingdom Hearts, but I'd say it's the best one, for sure. And yeah, I think it still holds up pretty well. Like, it's a bit clunky, but it's the product of its time, and I still enjoy playing this game.
Would you give this game your first 10 out of 5?
10 out of 5, exactly.
I really do love this game. Like, I apologize for this in an earlier part, but I do want to apologize again. I feel like I was too negative on this game, or more, I don't want to say negative, but more, maybe too critical for the game. And I don't really mean to do that in a, like, obnoxious way. I'm very critical over Kingdom Hearts just because I really love this series so much. And I love this game a lot, and the thing with this is, like, I'm so spoiled by other games in the series, so when I go back to this, it's so weird, I'm like, why isn't this like how it is in KH2? Which, yeah. It's not this game's fault. Like you said, it's a thing of the time, but I do love this game. It's definitely... I know when we first did this ending in the first part, I got kind of emotional, and I'll probably do it again. But, like, as weird as that sounds for an LP, but you get it attached to these things, it's weird. But I do love this series, because if it was not for Kingdom Hearts, I would not be the person who I am today. Like, I likely would not be here making YouTube videos or talking to Philip, which I'm very thankful for this series. In this game, I mean, I played Chain of Memories first, but even then, like, when I eventually did play this game, I didn't like it at first, but I fell in love with it, and, well, after, like, the second time I played through it, I fell in love with it, is what I should say. But I really do like this game. I think combat-wise, it still holds up pretty well. Obviously, later games, well, 2 specifically, yeah, 2. Does it a lot better. BBS, debatable.
2 and Recoded.
Okay, I'll give you that one. DDD, not so much, or Days. But, like, story-wise, I really... this is by far the best KH story. Like, it's very Disney-esque, and I'm not one of those people who I'm like, you know, it has to be either too Disney or too Square Enix. I don't really care. As long as it's
a good mix of both.
Decently written. Yeah. It can work.
I'm just going to, like, make a quick point, sorry, like, just to, about what you're saying. I think Tron and KH2 did the best combination of both, and I think if KH2, all the worlds were more like the Tron world, it would have been a better story than this game.
Yeah, I agree. But, yeah, like, I still really like KH1. I think world-wise, it got a pretty good amount of worlds that I do like. Besides Deep Jungle, I like about every world that I... Well, besides Deep Jungle and Atlantica, they're really the only two worlds I downright don't like. But, like, everything this game does, KH2 does it better, besides story-wise. But, like I said, music-wise, this game's really good. Gameplay-wise, it's really good. If you're gonna play Kingdom Hearts, obviously you need to play this game. I've seen a lot of videos on YouTube like, where to start with Kingdom Hearts? Obviously, you need to start with the first game. I mean, you know, it's just kind of common sense, but...
Always play in release order, folks. Even 1.5 and 2.5 lies to you in the menu. It lists days before KH2. It's like, why would you do that? Like, don't play days or don't watch days before KH2 because it spoils stuff in KH2. I hate the collections for doing that.
But, I really love this game. I wouldn't say this is like a game that I will go back to all the time, because if I'm going to replay a KH game, I'm going to play KH2. But, I definitely will come back to this one day, because I've had a lot of... I'm going to go into like what I think of the project so far. I'm really happy with how this LP turned out. Like, it was very fun to record, and the thing that I had a lot of fun recording this, and I always have fun recording LPs, like, gameplay-wise, like, footage, whatever, but I didn't really think, I was like, I'm gonna play this, and I know exactly what I'm gonna expect, because I've played this so much, but the thing is, when I played through this, I learned so much about this game, it was kind of like I was playing it for the first time again, so that was kind of awesome for me, because I was like, I don't know, it was just kind of cool. I was like, it feels like I'm playing NK-Tron all over again, back in 2000 and... when did I play this game? I think, I don't know. So it was really cool, and I'm not gonna get really emotional, I'm not trying to, but I really do appreciate this LP, because I won't go into it, but I've been through a pretty hard time recently, and I've had this LP here to keep me busy, and it's kind of been there for me, in a weird way, like, I don't know how to explain it, but I love Kingdom Hearts 1, this LP has definitely made me appreciate this game a lot more, so yeah, I don't really know what else I was going to say. I just really like this game. So, yeah. I played this game. It was pretty good.
I
really like how the LP turned out. Yeah. So, I feel like I'm forgetting something, but I don't know.
And as we're recording this, we're going to probably get the release date of KH3 tomorrow. So, it's all going full circle, in a way.
Also, this credits song, really good.
Yep, Oh, I mentioned this in our when I went to the KH Orchestra, Yoko played this for us live, and it was so good.
Yeah, with that, I mean, we really have, like, the secret ending, you know, where Thanos is gonna walk out and see the sunlight. That's a spoiler for Infinity War, but yeah.
But yeah, this leads straight into Chain of Memories. I even reuse this scene, like, specifically in Chain of Memories.
So Sora just looks at Goofy and he's like, "So Goofy, where'd you get those clothes?"
We've gotta find Riku and King Mickey.
But, where do we start looking for that there door to the light?
You brought this up earlier, but really KH could have ended here, and it probably would have worked. Like, really would have worked.
Pluto? Hey, Pluto! Where have you been?
Huh?
Gosh, that's the king's seal!
Hey, have you seen King Mickey?
Is he down the well, Pluto?
Let's go!
Yeah, this leads straight into Chain of Memories.
Yeah, Sora runs down that little path, and on the path, his balls drop and his voice gets deeper. That's actually what happens.
It happens right now. Let's go! Let's go, guys!
This secret ending is really good.
Thank you.
This CG has age, but this secret ending is still pretty badass. Like, it's kind of like edgy, but it's like edgy in an awesome way. So, I love it. Like, watching this, I'm just like, wow, I really just want KH3. And there's 2B.
And Roxas' hair looks weird here.
Yeah, it looks really weird. He doesn't look like Roxas in this at all. He looks more like Marluxia in this ending than he actually does Roxas. I feel like I have so much information thrown at me, I don't know how to comprehend all of this.
It's symbolic, look, it's a heart, and it's 2B!
It's symbolic! Kairi's design there looks so different compared to how she, does in 3. It's so weird.
Yeah, Kairi's design like looks weird here.
And here's how Cage 2 actually begins. Well, with the Sora standing there and doing nothing. This ending is weird. It's so confusing. Like, it's not confusing, but it's more like, it's just weird. But it is awesome. I like seeing him fight the Neo Shadows. The Neo Shadows in this look legit kind of freaky, I think.
I like how you can recreate Vecina 358 out of 2 days. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. I just want, can I just have KH3, please? That's all I want.
And by the way, the song's really good. another story.
Oh yeah, the BBS version of this song is really good as well.
I love this track.
This part's weird, because like you see KH1 and how it ends, and then it goes to this, and you're like, what the hell is this? Did I sign up for a Matrix movie?
God, the best part of the scene's coming up. Where the music drops here. Oh, it's so good.
It's sad, because like... My favorite thing is, like, they only made this scene because they're like, you know, we don't really know if we're going to get a sequel, so we're going to make this just in case we get a sequel. Because they really didn't think Cage... I don't think they... It's been said they didn't think Cage would do nearly as well as it really did. Like, it just kind of... It was like, a major shock to them. I hate that Mickey model.
Yeah, same.
I can't stand how it looks.
It kind of looks like he's 0.21. Honestly.
But yeah, we won't see, like, this actual stuff until... Well, we've already seen it, because we did Days, but we won't see this actual, like, plot thread continue until Cage 2, because the next Kingdom Hearts game we're going to do is Kingdom Hearts Rechain of Memories. My favorite Kingdom Hearts game. Yay. That's going to be a lot of fun to record. I'm joking. That'll be fun. Chain of Memories will be. Well, recording commentary will be fun. Gameplay-wise, probably not that fun, but you know. That's Kingdom Hearts 1. We have a little thing to pop up any second now. We have darkness within darkness here.
Darkness in zero.
Yeah, there we go. But yeah, so,
Why the fuck does Riku have a wing here? I know he's leaning
like
against a statue, but still.
Wait, is he really leaning against a statue?
Yeah, I think it is. Look, you can see the statue base next on the bottom of it. I don't think he literally has a wing.
Oh. It's symbolic!
He's like Sephiroth. Because Sephiroth's his dad, after all. That's a good way to end this LP.
Yeah. We'll see you guys next time with Kingdom Hearts stuff or Kingdom Hearts Rechain of Memories. See you guys next time.
See you next time.